Students are meeting tonight to discuss changes they want to see in the dining halls on campus.
And speaking of dining halls, our reporter Katie Fongvongsa looks at staffing in food services at the university.
Plus, the Student Association looks to decrease carbon emissions on a deadline. News Live at 6 starts right now.
This is Citrus TV News Live at 6, your campus news leader.
A group of students is looking to make changes to dining halls in the future on campus. Good evening, I'm Ryan Baker.
And I'm Katie Lane. Tonight at Falk College, there's a town hall for students to address concerns about the dining halls on campus. Our Citrus TV reporter, Zach Richter, joins us live outside Falk with more. Zach?
Good evening, Ryan and Katie. Happening here behind me at 7 p.m. inside room 200, there will be a town hall where students can address their questions, comments, and concerns about the dining halls here on campus. Organizers say the point of this event is to create positive change. Plus, there will be SU Food Services employees in attendance, including the head chef.
There were a lot of issues within that students had that were not getting to the administration. So this town hall tonight is focused rather than on the meal swipe options and whatnot, the actual quality of food at the dining halls that kids are eating and what their experiences are when they are going
to the dining halls. There, this is specifically only about the quality of food, but she's encouraging all students to attend and speak their concerns no matter how big or small the concern is. She says if she's told me that if students don't speak up, there will be no change. Also, she wants to better understand the needs and wants of all students. I'll have a full wrap-up tomorrow on Live at 6. Reporting from Falk College tonight, Zach Richter, Citrus TV News.
Zach, thank you. Syracuse University will still require proof of COVID-19 vaccination for employees. This comes after a federal court issued an injunction on a Biden administration mandate. The administration issued an executive order requiring federal contractors mandate COVID-19 vaccines for employees unless subject to medical or religious exemption. On Tuesday, a federal court's injunction put a temporary halt on this enforcement. Vice Chancellor Michael J. Haney said this in an email to the university this morning. Quote, given the uncertainty associated with the timeline and ultimate outcome of the pending legal challenge, Syracuse University will maintain plans announced in Monday's campus message to review and document proof of vaccine status for all existing and newly hired faculty and staff.
And here are the latest COVID-19 numbers at SU. There are currently 78 active cases on campus, an increase of 3 since yesterday. There are 7 new student cases and 2 new employee cases. There's a positivity rate of 0.4%, up from 0.1% yesterday.
Hendricks Chapel is hosting a remembrance service to commemorate the lives lost on Pan Am Flight 103. The service will include prayers and a reading of the 35 SU students who died on board when the flight was bombed. The event will take place on December 21st at 2:03 p.m., exactly 33 years after the tragic event in Lockerbie, Scotland in 1988.
And another change is coming to MySlice. SU announced that MySlice's security settings will be updated to reduce the number of multi-factor authentication pop-ups. This update will apply mainly to desktops, laptops, and SU public computers. The update will be effective beginning on Tuesday, December 14th.
Syracuse University is once again offering the Forever Orange Scholarship, this time for the class of 2022. The scholarship provides half off of the tuition costs for students who enroll in full-time in qualifying residential graduate degree or certificate programs at SU.
This unique opportunity is automatically available to all class of 22 graduating seniors. This has already been admitted to a qualifying graduate program are also eligible.
And the university is also encouraging undergraduates to apply to present at the ACC Meeting of the Minds, which will take place in April. The conference gives students the chance to showcase their work, network with others, and learn from their peers. Last year, Syracuse University faculty members chose 5 students based off of their proposals, research, and applications. You can apply online, and applications are due January 21st.
The Student Association is working with the university on cutting carbon emissions by the end of the next semester. Our reporter Ilana Epstein is live inside Schine with more. Ilana?
Thank you, Ryan. Right now I am standing inside of the Schine Student Center where the Syracuse University Student Association offices are located right behind me. Now, earlier today, I spoke with David Bruin, who is the president of the Student Association, and he gave me some very interesting information regarding carbon emission here at Syracuse. He told me that Syracuse plans to become both carbon neutral and carbon negative by the end of next semester. Now, this plan is happening a year ahead of when it was originally supposed to, and David told me that being carbon negative was not originally part of him and his vice president Jornell's campaign. He told me that he thinks it is extremely important for Syracuse University students to be aware of carbon emission here in Syracuse.
To restate and reemphasize the work and the advocacy that we're doing on the university level to advance the university's carbon neutral goal way ahead, so that Syracuse University can be a leader among other universities and go carbon neutral, we hope, by 2026.
Now, David said that this plan was announced late on Monday evening. Syracuse already gets around 35% of its energy consumption from both renewable and clean sources. Only 7 universities have reached total carbon neutrality. Syracuse is excited to be a part of this, and the Student Association is excited to help out. You can get more information about Syracuse University Student Association on their website. For CitrusTV News, I'm Ilana Epstein. Katie, Ryan, back to you.
Thank you, Ilana. The chancellor of SUNY colleges is stepping down. SUNY Chancellor Jim Maltross made comments about sexual assault allegations regarding former New York Governor Andrew Cuomo. The New York College Democrat and Republican clubs called for his resignation last week. This morning, he sent this in his resignation letter, saying, quote, "The recent events surrounding me over the past week have become a distraction over the important work that needs to be accomplished as SUNY emerges from COVID-19, end quote. Maltross's resignation will take effect January 14th, according to his letter.
Syracuse is receiving $10 million as a part of the Downtown Revitalization Initiative. New York State Governor Kathy Hochul made the announcement earlier today. The goals of the initiative is to help communities improve in the post-COVID-19 economy by transforming downtown areas into vibrant neighborhoods. Governor Hochul said that she wants to create a resurgence in the city and region. The 19th annual Hope for the Holidays fundraiser is returning tomorrow and Saturday. Volunteers will be selling special editions of the Post Standard. The money raised will be used to buy books, toys, and food for a pre-Christmas giveaway. You can find these volunteers throughout Syracuse and the suburbs, or you can donate via text, online, or by mail. Last year, they raised $54,000.
And Southwest Airlines will be launching nonstop seasonal flights from Syracuse Hancock International Airport to Tampa, Florida, beginning April 30th, that is. This will be an increase of the current number of flights going there. Southwest says they intend to use the full-size jet to provide this service.
One Starbucks location in Buffalo is on its way to unionizing after a long battle with the corporation. The store voted 19-8 this morning to unionize. The National Labor Relations Board is working on certifying the vote, a process expected to take about a week. The board is still counting votes for 2 other Buffalo stores. If certified, it would be the first Starbucks-owned store in the country to unionize.
And the latest on the New York gubernatorial race, New York Attorney General Letitia James is dropping out of the race. Instead, she is running for re-election as Attorney General. James announced her decision on Twitter, saying, quote, "I have come to the conclusion that I must continue my work as Attorney General. There are a number of important investigations and cases that are underway, and I intend to finish the job. I am running for a re-election to complete the work New Yorkers elected me to do."
Now, Katie, this week, really, winter just hit us full force. The coats are out, snow is on the ground, and I can't say I'm loving it.
Me neither, Ryan. I want the sunshine, 60-degree weather back. Sammy, what is it looking like outside right now? Do I need my jacket?
You do need your jacket, Katie, and unfortunately, we're not going to be seeing that 60-degree weather for a little while, but we might actually see it at the end of this week. But right now it's 30 degrees and we're under overcast skies and we're seeing some 5-mile-per-hour winds. So the winds aren't too bad compared to yesterday and at the beginning of this week. So it doesn't feel as cold as it is outside. Going into tonight, temperatures are going to be around 33 degrees. There is going to be a chance of snow showers. So if you're not a big fan of the snow, then maybe this is a good night to stay in and just cozy up with a book or watch Netflix or something. Katie Lane, I'm talking to you right now. And those wind speeds are going to be around 5 to 10 miles per hour. So they are going to pick up a little bit, but not too much. And going into tomorrow at 9 a.m., it's going to be 37 degrees. It's going to warm up to 45 at 3 p.m. and drop back down to 41 at 6 p.m. It's going to be pretty cloudy in the morning, but in the afternoon, we're going to see a little bit of sun. That's all I have for you guys right now. Back to you.
Thank you so much, Sammy. Coming up after the break, we have the latest about a potential subpoena against former President Donald Trump.
And President Biden has a plan to reduce carbon emissions. Stay with us to find out more.
They said a bottle was just a bottle. That no one would ever notice me. But I knew I could be more. That one day, I would make people smile.
Here we go. We're gonna go out there in the rain. We're gonna get wet. All right, here we go. Oh, no. Oh, look at the rain. Okay, quick. Oh, yeah, yes. So much fun. Mwah. Yeah, Dad. We're getting so wet.
Visit aarp.org/caregiving for information on how to provide even better care for the person who wants to care of you.
You're watching Citrus TV News with Ryan Baker, Katie Lane, Sammy Lindell, and Erica Love. Citrus TV News, your campus news leader.
Welcome back to News Live at 6. The university is still experiencing a staffing shortage, but food services has a slightly different story. Citrus TV reporter Katie Fongvongsa has more about their employees. Katie?
Thank you, Katie. The university is currently experiencing a staffing shortage, but this is not necessarily the case for SU's food services department, which involves multiple dining halls, centers, and cafes. I spoke to Susan Bracey, the director of residential dining, about how food services was able to recover before going into this school year.
Stimulus check went away and people weren't getting paid extra to stay home. We've been able to hire right along. We're hiring 4, 5, 6 people a week to fill our positions, right? So we're almost at full capacity right now.
Even though food services was able to recover, Bracey tells me that they have increased their base pay to $16 an hour. This plays a part as hiring is getting better by the week. Student employment still proved to be difficult in the earlier in the year, and Bracey says the anticipation of Carrier Dome staffing fell under expectations.
Hiring is tough, right? A lot of students don't want to work. So we're down in student employees right now. Originally, it was the Carrier Dome where we were hurting for staff, only because we had been closed for a couple of years, right? So typically, we would have 150, 200 students coming back every year that had worked for us.
Now hiring is hitting full employment and becoming stabilized. Promotion and retirements are expected. Many applicants and interviews go on every day fulfilling these empty positions. Coming next semester, food services will reopen closed cafes and possibly extend operational hours. Katie and Ryan, back to you.
Thank you, Katie. The latest in the Northeast, National Guard medics are helping out across New York State in response to low capacity at medical facilities. The governors of Maine and New York deployed 120 medics and medical technicians to a dozen long-term care facilities in New York.
Hochul said she may deploy the Guard to hospitals as well. About 50 hospitals in northern New York had less than 10% bed capacity as of last week due to staffing shortages.
The parents of two sisters who survived the Oxford High School shooting are suing a total of $200 million. The parents are suing the school district, the principal, the dean of students, and other school officials.
The day before the shooting, the shooter's teacher found him searching for ammunition on his phone. A teacher also found a drawing of a gun in a person who had been shot on the morning of the shooting. The school was aware of these signs as they told the parents to put him in counseling within 48 hours or risk being reported to child services.
Attorney General Letitia James' civil fraud investigation into former President Donald Trump's business practices continues. James is looking to subpoena Trump on January 7, 2022 for questioning in his deposition.
If James finds evidence of wrongdoing, she could file a lawsuit against the former president. This comes as New York City Governor General Cyrus R. Vance Jr. is pushing to determine whether Trump engaged in a pattern of criminal fraud for a separate criminal investigation.
And more on Donald Trump. A federal appeals court is not allowing President Trump to shield documents from the House committee investigating the January 6th insurrection at the Capitol. The court blocked Trump's effort to block the records through executive privilege.
The committee says Trump's records are vital to the investigation and the events leading up to the deadly riot. President Joe Biden also determined that the documents are in public interest and executive privilege should not be invoked.
President Biden is looking to make the federal government carbon neutral. Biden signed an executive order yesterday that aims to reduce carbon emissions entirely by the year 2050.
This includes slashing carbon dioxide emissions by 65% by 2030. Biden has also established a Buy Clean policy instructing the federal government to use lower emission construction materials. This would put the U.S. on target globally to get net zero emissions by 2100.
New details, President Biden is calling for world leaders to work together and demonstrate how democracies can work for the people after holding a summit for democracy earlier today.
He called the issue an urgent matter, saying, quote, "The data we're seeing is largely pointing in the wrong direction," end quote. The summit comes as Biden continues to press Russia's President Putin to stand down after a massive buildup of troops in Russian-Ukraine border.
And the U.S. is enforcing its Remain in Mexico policy. The first two migrants were sent back to Mexico yesterday under the policy where they must wait for their hearings in U.S. immigration court.
The move comes even as the Biden administration looks to end the policy in a way that stands against any legal scrutiny. A lawsuit from Texas and Missouri forced Biden to put the policy back into effect.
And coming up, we take a look at your weekly weather update. Stay tuned.
I see you mobbing over her. Let's go. Let's mob. Let's crawl. Mm-hmm. Let's crawl. Mm-hmm. Let's crawl. Mm-hmm. Hey, yo, we mobbing. Come on, girl. Let's crawl. Mm-hmm. Hey, yo, let's crawl. Hey, yo, let's crawl. Hey, let's crawl. Hey, yo, let's crawl.
From the Citrus TV Weather Center, this is SU's most accurate weather forecast.
Welcome back, everybody. Let's take a look at your temperatures across Central New York. Now, in the Eastern Rome, we have a low of Central New York at 27 degrees. Moving over the west in Rochester, we're at 29 degrees. In the north in Fulton, it's 28. And our highs are in Ithaca and Elmira at 32 degrees across Central New York. Now, for our five-day forecast, it's honestly looking pretty nice. I mean, pretty good for December anyways. We got some clouds today, tomorrow, some rain on Saturday, but I'm really looking forward to Sunday and Monday. It's actually gonna warm up a little bit for December, and we're gonna see some sun in the afternoons of both days. Now on Saturday, it is going to rain, and I know that's a game day, so Noah, what's going on in the world of sports?
Yeah, Sammy, you mentioned that when Syracuse travels down to Washington, D.C., they might be setting fire to the rain because this Orange team is ablaze. And coming up in sports, I'll let you know if the Orange have the chance to extinguish recent play when they travel to Georgetown this weekend. Don't go anywhere.
They told me a bottle couldn't dream. That I would never become a superhero. But I learned how to fly. Just to come back in a new disguise. And be the hero that I've always wanted to be.
Superheroes?
Just four brothers who hate bullies and love this city.
It's a beautiful day out here, sunny today with light breezes, giving way to clouds in the afternoon. We could see some light precipitation to moderate precipitation later on, followed by powerful storm-like conditions. 90 miles per hour winds are expected. Authorities are asking everyone, stay indoors.
And now, your Citrus TV Sports Report.
Syracuse basketball is winding down on its non-conference schedule. And if you ask Jim Boeheim, the nightmare couldn't end any sooner. Welcome into sports. I'm Noah Searson. The Orange suffered a beatdown in Madison Square Garden to Villanova on Tuesday night and have another former Big East foe lined up this weekend. But before SU hits the road again, Coach Boeheim said the Orange need to get back to the basics. Unfortunately for Coach Boeheim, Deion Waiters, who he mentions in that spot, he doesn't have any more eligibility, but SU has plenty of offensive firepower to bounce back. Buddy Boeheim still averaging over 17 per game, despite scoring 6 points in back-to-back games, so getting him some open looks will be key. On the other side, the Hoyas sport a top 20 rebounding squad, which ended up being SU's demise against Nova. I'll have full coverage down in D.C., so be sure to stay tuned at Citrus TV Sports on Twitter, along with Ad and Searson for that noon tip-off. We'll kick it over to football on the Hill now, as Syracuse Athletics announced today its first of many new coaching hires after three coaches were let go following this season. Bob Ligashevsky takes over as the special teams coordinator in the Salt City after the position was vacant all of last year. Ligashevsky comes to SU with 37 years coaching experience, including his most recent one-year stint in Bowling Green. He'll have to hit the ground running in Syracuse because you see it right there. The Orange stunk on special teams a year ago. The once a famed punter U turned into the worst unit in the ACC, and former Lou Groza Award winner Andre Schmidt, he wasn't much better either. In fact, he also finished dead last in the kicking game. And as long as we're on the topic of teams who struggle in the kicking game, the Vikings play tonight. Maybe a bit of a low blow for a team that's coming off a loss to the previously winless Lions, but Kirk Cousins will take the best touchdown to interception ratio in the NFL into battle against the Steelers squad looking to make it two straight and, more importantly, vault themselves into the playoff picture. I will say, as a Minnesotan born and bred, I'm not feeling great about this one, but you never know because weird things happen on Thursday nights in the NFL, Katie and Ryan.
Noah, thank you.
And now we are going to turn to some breaking news. Moments ago, a jury found actor Jussie Smollett guilty on at least one count. He lied and staged a racist attack. Stay with us for the latest.
Your girls have been with you through every moment of your life. They were with you when you felt unbreakable. With you that time you felt most alone. And with you when you realized you would never be. They were with you when you shared your love with the world. And with you when she became your world. Your girls have never left you. They're still with you right now. But how well do you know them?
You don't know my
Knowing your breasts can save your life.
It's a beautiful day out here, sunny today with light breezes, giving way to clouds in the afternoon. We could see some light precipitation to moderate precipitation later on, followed by powerful storm-like conditions. 70 miles per hour winds are expected. Authorities are asking everyone, stay indoors.
Come on, that's it, let's go.
Welcome back, everybody. Now, for my last weather this semester, I just wanted to congratulate Katie. She's going to Newhouse LA next semester, and we're going to miss her so much. She was amazing as GM. She was a great mentor to me. She's a great anchor and producer, and we just all love her so much. And this is Katie and Ryan, our lovely anchors. We're going to see Ryan next semester, but I really just want to take this time to say thank you so much to Katie, and I love you, and we all love you. And Ryan, you too, but we have one more semester with you. But that's all I have for you guys. For one last time, Ryan, Katie, back to you.
Thank you, Sammy.
Yes, thank you so much, Sammy. As you just said, today does mark Katie's last day as a News Live at 6 anchor. Katie, it has been a part of the news department since her freshman year at SU. She started as a day reporter and worked her way up to the anchor desk by her sophomore year. She also served as an executive producer, and be sure to tune in to her final show tomorrow at 6 p.m. And for those of you who may not know, Katie is currently my roommate here in Syracuse and has been one of my best friends since freshman year. Katie, I'm continually in awe of all that you do here on campus and for CitrusTV, and I'm going to miss you so much. I know this isn't goodbye. We have a bright future ahead of us, but I'm going to miss you quite a lot.
Thank you, Ryan. I'm going to miss you so much, and everybody here at Syracuse. It has been a pleasure co-anchoring with you this semester and last semester, too, and just the past 4 years being a part of the news department. You guys have become my family here at SU, and it's so sad to be saying goodbye. But like you said, it's not really goodbye, it's see you later. You guys have been an amazing cast of characters in the story of my life. But for those of you who don't know, like Sammy said, I'll be trading snowy Syracuse for sunny California next month. But like I said, it's been a pleasure working with all of you guys, and be sure to keep up the great work, and go Orange, as you saw in the photo, Ryan and I, big sports fans here. But no, this has really been great.
I'm sad that we may not have another game day together for quite some time.
Not as students,
absolutely. Yeah. That is a very good point. But that is all the time we have for today on CitrusTV News.
For more of the latest, follow us on CitrusTV News on Twitter or check out our website at citrustv.com.
For all of us here at CitrusTV News, I'm Ryan Baker.
And for the last time, I'm Katie Lane. Have a great night and a safe break, Syracuse.